We met her when she was 20. She just turned 40. In the last two decades, we've seen her meteoric rise to the top.
Good morning, Ms. Houston.
We also saw her seemingly self-destructive plunge to the bottom. She is now more frequently seen in gossip columns than concert halls. Her image selling tabloids, not CDs. Drama, dirt, and drugs.
The only question that I always have for Whitney, is she high? Is she high?
In the next hour, we'll examine the good Whitney, the bad Whitney, and the question. 40 years old, it's not right, but is she okay? Tonight, we will look back at Whitney Houston's turbulent career and show you the star like you have never seen her, up close, through exclusive footage. It is a long, windy spiritual journey that begins in a New Jersey church and ends 40 years later, halfway around the world, knee-deep in the River Jordan. It all started here in Newark, the beautiful girl with the angelic voice singing at the New Hope Baptist Church. She was called Nippy then, still in the shadow of her famous relatives.
She was brought up on gospel, so naturally, gospel music was her first love.
This is Whitney's cousin, singer Dionne Warwick.
Her belief in God is very strong. Her faith is unwavering.
Whitney's mother was a famed gospel singer. Sissy Houston warned her daughter from the very start about the vicious industry she was heading into.
When I decided to become an entertainer, she said, "Oh, you want to be a singer, huh? Mm-hmm." And she said, "Well, do you want to be in show business?" I said, "Well, isn't that the same thing? I mean, I want to sing, so that's what I want to do." She said, "No, no, no. It's a whole different world."
By 17, Whitney was appearing in New York nightclubs with her mother.
She was absolutely phenomenal.
Jerry Griffith was the talent scout who discovered Whitney.
I mean, this lady has the guts of life, you know. At 18 years old, she was just phenomenal.
Griffith introduced Whitney to his boss, Arista president Clive Davis, who would make her his protege, guiding her to one of the most successful careers in music history. She was barely more than 20 years old when her first album became the best-selling female debut album in history. And since then, 8 consecutive multi-platinum albums, over 100 million sold. Whitney's songs would become the soundtrack of a generation.
There's no one in pop music that can touch this lady. She is number one. And with that voice, I mean, how could you not be, you know?
By 1992, she became a bankable movie actress, starring in The Bodyguard. The movie's soundtrack became the most successful ever released.
I'll Always Love You is beautiful in the way of like a woman on her wedding day. Like, it begins with this ornate, delicate a cappella space where she's just singing.
If I should stay.
And it's so perfect, and then it grows and grows.
And
you're building toward that sonic climax the whole time.
I wish you love.
And then she comes to that note, right? And the drum kicks, boom.
And I will always love you.
And it's like Michael Jordan leaping from the free throw line.
But as Whitney took her God-given talent to new heights, she had to turn to God to face the lows of show business, the grueling schedule, the incessant tabloids.
First conversation I had with her was about the Lord.
This is sax player Kirk Whalum. He accompanied Whitney at the height of her career.
I kind of had the unofficial position of chaplain of the group. She called me Bishop.
He was there in the background, watching the daily grind of success slowly chip away at the icon.
I was praying really, really hard for her during that period. There's a madness that people would never believe that happens to an individual who gets that famous.
Once things started to happen to me, once I became famous and all of these things, you know, people were saying about me, you know, that weren't true, and hurt me.
There's nothing to describe it. It's just like you're spinning around, and there's nothing to hold on to.
There's a road I have to follow.
In 1989, she held on to another superstar, Bobby Brown. But many believe the man she ultimately grabbed onto did not anchor Whitney, he sank her.
Yes, Bobby is the man of my life, and I'm very much in love and I'm very happy.
Hey, fellas, gather around, let me tell you about a girl who's blowing my mind.
Like her, he launched his career in his teens, and by the time they met, he was well on his way to having four hits in the top five. They had stardom in common, but she was buttoned up in sequin gowns. He liked taking his clothes off on stage. There seemed to be no connection and definitely no future.
When you first heard about that union, that they were getting together, Whitney and Bobby,
right.
First thing you thought?
Right. No, I didn't think it was real. I didn't think it was real at first.
Are they for real? Are they serious?
If tomorrow is judgment day.
I mean, people had bets on us, like we're going to make it, like, no, 6 weeks. No, try it. 6 months. No, 6 weeks, believe me.
In 1993, Bobby Christina, Whitney and Bobby's only child, was born.
Oh, that's beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Beautiful music, beautiful, beautiful girl, beautiful music.
But reports of family bliss in glossy magazines only told part of Bobby's story. Police reports did the rest.
They say I'm crazy. I really don't care. That's not the rock and chill.
Battery, more battery. Simulating sex on stage, speeding, driving under the influence twice, he almost got killed in a deadly shootout, of course drug possession, and if you can't make out the writing, that says he urinated in the back of a police car.
It's the way that I want to live.
He served time for DUI and probation violations. And Whitney has been by his side through it all. 11 years of marriage and going strong.
Love eternally.
Is it a match made in heaven? It's certainly paparazzi paradise.
I get so emotional, baby.
She's there for the perp walks, the court appearances.
It just kept people interested in her when they may have said, okay, we've heard enough of Whitney. Oh, wait a minute.
Stay strong, baby. I got your back.
She's seen sending him off to jail, and here in 2000, waiting for him as he comes out.
I get so emotional, baby.
Oh, wait a minute. She's outside the prison for waiting for Bobby. Oh, wait a minute. Here they're making out on stage at some show. Oh.
And these pictures are from this past August, Whitney coming to Bobby's court hearing.
Good morning, Ms. Houston. How are you?
Mrs. Brown.
Mrs. Brown.
She's standing up before the people and saying, he's mine.
Right.
I love him.
How are you?
We're well, thank you.
We? You and the camera? Come here, please back up.
Gonna
make out good today. You got footage, baby. You only one.
Well, it's good to see you.
You too, take care.
Take care of yourself.
I will.
Tell Bobby we said hello, okay?
I will, love. Take care, bye.
Thank you.
God bless you.
New York radio personality Wendy Williams.
They love each other and they share the secret.
Which is?
You know. That's a huge secret.
Are you looking at me?
Of course, it may be one of the worst-kept secrets in showbiz. But what do we really know? She smiled at us from one magazine cover to the next. In the early 90s, Whitney Houston was an undisputed diva, a voice that could do no wrong. But by decade's end, gradually, her public image cracked to reveal her looking like this.
There are two things that make Whitney not so reliable. Number one, she's a superstar. Number two, the problem.
It first became noticeable in the late 90s. A string of appearances and disappearances raised the possibility that Whitney Houston may have a problem.
She would cancel concerts, she would be late on stage.
Biographer James Robert Parrish can list one public appearance canceled after the next. Throat problems, exhaustion, city after city, shorter and shorter notice. In Concord, California, just minutes before she was to go on stage. So what exactly was the problem? When Whitney Houston called Wendy on the radio in early 2003, it was time to have that all-important chat.
Ring, ring. On your radio show, okay, on that day. You probably will never forget it,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Wendy, Wendy, Wendy.
Wendy, Wendy, Wendy.
Oh, my gosh.
Oh, my Lord, have I waited for this day.
That was the most erratic, weird interview I'd ever heard.
I was shocked that Whitney actually called.
Whitney actually called WBLS, one of the nation's top urban radio stations, to promote her latest album. But Wendy had more pressing topics in mind.
You smoke weed?
Oh, shit.
Isn't that the first thing that everybody wonders when they see Whitney? I wonder if she's high. Whitney's got a new album out. She's going to be at the megastore signing it. I wonder if she's high. Whitney's going to be on Oprah. Ooh, let me turn it on. I wonder if she's high.
So, Whitney, is there drug use going on at this present time?
Who are you talking to?
To you, Whitney. You.
No, you're not talking to me. I'm a mother. Only my mother has privy to that information. You talk to your child about that. Don't ask me no questions like I'm a child. Because I'm not a child, Wendy.
It's so hard to show the whole world what I do. Now I'm turning the cameras back on you.
Whitney would not answer the question.
One minute, your girlfriend's. She's loving you, you're loving
yeah,
her.
Yeah.
I love you more.
Yeah.
Okay?
Then she's threatening
what was that?
To meet me downstairs and beat me
yeah.
up.
Wendy, I love you because you support me and you've been good to me on the radio. However, you know, watch what you say, baby girl.
But Whitney, watch what you do. And if
I know it's not. You don't even know what I do. Like you said, you never met me. You don't know me. You ain't been in my house. You don't live with me. You don't sleep with me. You don't do shit with me. But talk about me. So watch what you say. That's all, baby girl. That's all I'm asking you is watch what the you say.
It's hard to pay attention to what Whitney wants us to focus on, mm-hmm. because me. Mm-hmm. I'm so focused on, is she high?
Do you live a relatively normal life?
No.
Whitney, you keep yourself in the headlines.
No, Wendy, y'all keep me in the headlines. I mind my business. I try to maintain what I got. Y'all want to know what I'm doing all the time. I don't give a shit about what you're doing all the time. How could you do it to me?